A systematic review and meta-analysis by Sidney Rubinstein, published in the British Medical Journal, looked at spinal manipulation for the treatment of chronic low back pain. This study included 47 randomized controlled trials with a total of 9,211 participants with low back pain. When looking at the literature, what they found is that when they compared spinal manipulative therapy compared to other recommended treatments by the clinical practice guidelines, so like exercise, what they found is that there was moderate quality evidence that found that there was no difference in the treatments at 1 or 12 months. They did find that there was a statistically significant improvement in the spinal manipulative therapy groups, although that difference wasn't clinically significant. And then when they looked at function, what they found is that the spinal manipulative therapy had a statistically significant improvement at 1 month, but then there was no difference at 6 or 12 months. And when they compared spinal manipulative therapy to non-recommended treatments, what they found is that there was a high quality evidence to support that there was a small statistical difference between spinal manipulative therapy and non-recommended treatments. And then for 6 months, which was intermediate term care, they found that there was moderate evidence. And for 12 months of care, which was long-term care, they found that there was low quality evidence supporting that spinal manipulative therapy was superior to non-recommended treatments. When comparing spinal manipulative therapy and non-recommended treatments in terms of function, what they found is that spinal manipulative therapy produced small to moderate improvements that were both statistically and clinically significant compared to those non-recommended treatments at both 1, 6, and 12 months. The study concluded that spinal manipulative therapy can be used as a standalone treatment for chronic low back pain, although it's typically part of a package that includes exercise. And the thing to consider is that because spinal manipulative therapy is considered a passive therapy, that the way that it's presented to patients need to make sure that it's not creating dependency and that providers are empowering patients to maintain being active while dealing with chronic low back pain and not solely relying on manipulative therapy. This study also looked at the potential harms associated with spinal manipulative therapy for chronic low back pain, and they cited another recent systematic review that had found that the complications of spinal manipulative therapy are thought to be pretty rare, and the actual conditions that they had found were either cauda equina syndrome, fracture, neurologic, and/or vascular compromise, although, as just mentioned, those complications are rare given the evidence that has been found. And when we look at the results of this study, it's interesting because although spinal manipulative therapy is a polarizing topic when it comes to the treatment of low back pain, one of the things that's most commonly said is that there's not evidence supporting the use of spinal manipulative therapy. However, this was a systematic review and meta-analysis which included close to 50 studies and almost 10,000 individuals, and they found that spinal manipulative therapy was just as effective as other recommended treatments, and this is on par with the other clinical practice guidelines, which have recommended that along with exercise and cognitive behavioral therapy, that spinal manipulation is an effective treatment option as well. Another argument that's typically brought up is that the effect sizes are generally small for spinal manipulation when it comes to low back pain, but when we look at the evidence as a whole, the effect sizes for a lot of treatments, all treatments, are small to moderate. We don't have a treatment option that consistently produces good results when it comes to treating low back pain, especially chronic low back pain. Even though exercise is recommended as a treatment, the effect sizes for exercises are small to moderate, and nobody really argues that we shouldn't be prescribing exercise for chronic low back pain based on its small effect sizes. And so I think really when it comes down to it, we just need to realize that our effect sizes in terms of pain aren't very good. We don't have good treatment options that produce large effect sizes when it comes to pain for chronic low back pain. And the other argument is typically the lack of difference between a sham manipulation and a regular manipulation. And this systematic review and meta-analysis actually looked at it, and what they found is that for pain, there wasn't much of a difference between the two groups. But when they looked at function, they found that there was a statistical and clinical significance between the sham group and the manipulation groups. And one of the interesting things when we discuss this is that it's really hard to actually create a sham manipulation group, especially if someone has had experience with spinal manipulation. They know if they've received the treatment or not. And when we look at exercise, this is a similar issue that we have in that it's hard to create a sham exercise group. We can look at specific exercise versus general exercise, and so like a spinal stabilization program versus walking, but both of those are still a form of exercise, and when we've actually done those studies, they haven't found superior outcomes between either of those two groups. They both seem to be helpful. In summary, spinal manipulation produces similar treatment effects as other recommended treatments for chronic low back pain. Therefore, when we're looking for an effective treatment option for chronic low back pain, spinal manipulation is one of those treatment options, and it's supported by a large systematic review and meta-analysis, which included 47 randomized controlled trials, as well as just over 9,000 participants.